Hi, everybody. Hi, Sam. Hi, everybody.
Hi, Sam.
So, welcome to Style Prototyping, the lab of the future. Who am I? Well, I'm Sam Richard, senior front-end developer at NBC Universal. I am Snugug on Twitter, GitHub, and really generally the internet, and I'm the co-organizer of Team Sass and SassCon. Now, before I get started, I want to warn you guys, if you've never seen me speak before or have never followed me on like Twitter or any of the issue queues, I'm a little bit opinionated, and I can at times be very sarcastic, but it's sarcastic in a loving way, not in a rude way, I promise. So don't be offended if I ask you to raise your hand and then tell you what you're doing is wrong, because it happens a bit, because it's a shtick I've got, let's say. Additionally, this might not be entirely what you expected. This presentation and the code base that I'm gonna be showing you guys and helping you hopefully get started with is a little bit new and a little bit weird. It's taken me about a full year to really convince my company that this is what we should be using and this is the way that we should be doing it. And while we've gotten a whole bunch of the pieces while we've worked on a whole bunch of the pieces individually, we've just really started within the past couple months getting everyone to actually be on board with the entire process all at once, as opposed to a piece of the process at the beginning, and then a piece of the process at the middle, and then some of the process at the end. So while we have done everything, it's a new process, and new processes take time to get implemented. So don't be dissuaded if you want to go and do this when you get back to your jobs and people say no. Just keep hammering at them. That's how I convince them that this is the way to go. Finally, I like audience participation, because audience participation means that I know that I'm not speaking to a bunch of people who are sleeping. So if I ask questions, and it will happen, please just yell out and answer the questions. Savvy?
Yeah.
Savvy. Cool. So, before we get started, a quiz.
One of these things is not like the others. One of these things doesn't belong. Can you tell which thing is not like the others before I finish my song?
So, which one of these is not like the other? Who thinks Photoshop is not like the other? Who thinks the tractor is not like the other? Who thinks Google Chrome is not like the other? Who thinks Adobe Illustrator is not like the other? Who has seen this quiz before and is cheating? There we go. So, the answer is Google Chrome is not like the other. Why? It's the only web design tool. These are graphic design tools. This is a farming tool. You wouldn't use a farming tool to design a website. You shouldn't use a graphic design tool to design a website. And I should probably silence that. The web and print are different mediums. We need to treat them differently. Oh, wow. Yeah, we need to treat them, keyboard stop. Oh, that was right. We need to treat them differently. Sorry, I thought I had another bullet point there. So, who here has ever read the article, The Tao of Web Design by John Aslop? Raise your hand. Fantastic. So, who here has read Responsive Web Design by Ethan Marcotte? This is the article that Ethan got his idea from. This is the article that Ethan quotes and points out at the very beginning of the article that defined the term responsive web design. April 7th, 2000, probably a decent year for wine, but more importantly, this article is over 13 and a half years old. I encourage you all to go read this article after this lab or at some point during this week. This is a 13 and a half year old article that's still on web design, that still holds relevance today. When it was written about accessibility, but the points that it makes still hold true for the state of the web today. and it's very important. So, to get started, I'm going to summarize it for you, but I still encourage you to read the whole thing. Ritual. Well-established hierarchies are not easily uprooted. Closely held beliefs are not easily released. So ritual enthralls generation after generation. Before there was web, before the web, there was print. Hundreds of years of print. Before there was print, there was writing. Thousands of years of writing. So really, it was only natural that when the web came about, we borrowed heavily from print. This is a quote from the article. When a new medium borrows from an existing one, some of what it borrows makes sense, but much of what it is borrowing is thoughtless ritual and often constrains the new medium. Over time, the new medium develops its own conventions, throwing off existing conventions that don't make sense. This happened with the transition from radio to television. Often referred to as radio with pictures, early television followed the same format as popular radio programs at the time, even going so far as to narrate on screen, narrate to the audience, the viewing audience, what is happening on screen. Good example of this, if I can find my mouse, is how we do it.
Well, howdy doody, and hiya, Mr. Smith.
Well, hello, howdy doody. Looks kind of happy today, doesn't he? Hi, kids.
Hi, kids over here. Come on, let's sing that theme now. You boys and girls at home, you join us.
Let's go. Here we go. The last line I want you to sing, too, the line that goes, I'm for howdy doody. Let me hear that. Come on.
I'm for howdy doody.
All right, now you watch Clarabelle, and here we go. This is howdy's favorite song. Campaign week, so come on, let's go. Oh, I'm for howdy doody. Are you?
Yes, I am.
That's the way.
My eyes. So if anyone's seen or listened to old radio shows, you'll notice that old radio shows start off with a big generator.
Yes, I am.
Because to the radio, there's no visual, so they need to fill the airspace.
You can look all night, look
so,
all day.
Howdy doody, look on
from Maine to California, I think. Ask any doctor, lawyer, Indian,
and
they
sure
all
now
share the same family. That there for howdy doody, are you?
Yes, I am.
Okay, now.
We're for howdy doody.
Wow.
Yes,
that's the way, kid. Howdy doody, how did you like hearing that, little fella?
Well, Mr. Smith, that was, oh, it was just wonderful. It's so thrilling when the boys and girls sing my song so loud.
Yes, and you should certainly be thrilled, you know. I was talking with Clarabelle before, and you know that the votes are pouring in for you, and I understand that you've been leading Howdy Doody, and we're going to be checking the vote doodle a little later, okay?
Oh, wonderful, Mr. Smith. I'm so happy over all the boys and girls votes. So well, what's that? Listen.
The voice of Mr. X.
Mr. X, listen.
The election is close, and I still expect to win.
Listen.
But no matter who wins, you will see me election night when I will positively appear on the Howdy Doody show.
You'll be here, that's
now, I would be interested in knowing what you think I look like. Please fill out the X chart, and I will tell you later if you were right or wrong.
The voice box says it's the voice of Mr. X. They're driving home to
the X chart, Howdy Doody. Age, weight, height, color of hair, mustache, birthplace, fat or thin, color of eyes. Howdy, is it all right with you if the boys and girls in the peanut gallery have to fill this in, okay? Well, I guess so. Maybe it'd help us if we knew what that old Mr. X looked like, Mr. Smith. All right, come on, kids. Look, this is a chart that Mr. X left here. Now, what he wants us all to do, and I think it's a good idea because then we'll get an idea as to what you kids think he looks like. Sonny, would you sit over just a little bit? That's the way. And I'm going to hold this little girl on my lap. Now, Clarabelle, will you work with the card there? Now, the age. How old do you think Mr. X is? Somebody raise your hand. But how about this little girl? Stand up, please.
use.
How old do you think Mr. X is?
From radio and applying it
about
to
63.
Without considering the fact that with television, oh, what, you can what, see what's going on.
Catherine, all right. You put down 63 there, Clarabelle. Now, what is the next line there? The weight. How about this young lady? Would you stand?
HTML5 video is still a little bit wonky. Sorry about that. So, it also happened with the introduction of music videos. Who is old enough to remember the very first video ever played on MTV? Call out if you know what it is. Whoever said, well, we'll get to that in a second. So, early music videos, and mostly what we would consider music videos, what we remember as music videos, is bands miming their songs as if they're playing right in front of us. It's kind of boring. Who guessed video killed the radio star? Yeah.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Cases, the thoughtless rituals of their parent mediums were cast off, while the ones that made sense to the new medium's conventions flourished. Television evolved genres and formats suited for visual storytelling.
How do we turn this off? Can you help me with this? Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. I didn't mean to snap. Good morning. Many of you are halfway through your first week here at Greendale, and as your dean, I thought I would share a few thoughts of wisdom and inspiration. What is community college? Well, you've heard all kinds of things. You've heard it's loser college for remedial teens, 20-something dropouts, middle-aged divorcees, and old people keeping their minds active as they circle the drain of eternity. That's what you heard. However, I wish you luck! Okay, you know, Okay, there's more to this speech. There's actually a middle card that is missing. Can we all look around our immediate areas? Because I really wanted to.
So, while it may not seem obvious because we're used to this kind of television, there's a lot that just went on there. We started off with the bells that sounded like proper school bells, and then as we panned out, we saw that it was a boombox. We saw that the dean was reading off of cards, which is the only reason why the end of that joke makes sense, is because we know he's reading off of cards. We weren't told that, we saw that. Even the, and this is really super gimmicky, and we probably all thought it was gimmicky when he said, the teenage, the 20-something dropout, and it pans to Britta. The dichotomy of what he's saying mixed with the person who they're talking to, but that's something that can only exist inside of a visual medium. It doesn't really work well inside of an audio medium. Television has evolved, and really, music videos has evolved too. Artists found that they could make music videos, and they could visually express themselves through these music videos in ways other than simply miming themselves singing a song.
We'll be right back.
Beastie Boys found that while singing Sabotage could have been amusing, it would be much more fitting to who they are as a band and the feel of the song to do a little 80s cop sketch. So that's what they did. They were able to express themselves visually in the world of music video as opposed to music audio. Although the web medium sprang from print, print's conventions have for far too long overshadowed the realities of the web. The web has been treated as if it's been made of paper. It is time for the web, like other mediums before it, to cast off the constraining rituals of the medium from which it emerged. Part 2, control. The sage accepts the ebb and flow of things, nurtures them, but does not own them. One of the core understandings of print design is what you see is what you get. The designer has absolute pixel-perfect control over the design. Does this sound familiar to anyone doing web design? Yeah. There is a fixed content size, fixed display size, and fixed viewing mode when you're dealing with print. Guess what? The web's not a laser printer. What if print's control is really its limitation? You can think we can fix the size of the text, or you can think the size of the text is unalterable. You can think the dimensions of a page can be controlled, or the dimensions of the page can't be altered. In print's limitations, we find the web's strength, flexibility. A newborn is soft and tender, a crone hard and stiff. Plants and animals, in life, are supple and succulent. In death, withered and dry. So softness and tenderness are attributes of life, and hardness and stiffness are attributes of death. Finally, the way. The way is shaped by use, but then the shape is lost. Do not hold fast to shapes, but let sensation flow into the world as a river courses down to the sea. Form should follow function. Start with what your pages do, not with what they look like. Regardless of how they got there, your users are there for your content, not for what your page looks like. Is anyone familiar with Maslow's hierarchy of human needs? Raise your hand. Awesome. So, for those of you who aren't, this is Maslow's hierarchy of human needs. It basically sets a pyramid of the core items needed for humans to survive, the base being the absolute underpinnings. Humans absolutely need these or else they physically will not survive. The top being kind of fluffy things that are nice to have that make you a well-rounded human but aren't necessary for survival. So at the bottom of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you've got things like breathing, food, water, sex. Next, you've got safety, which is housing, safety of body, employment, resources, etc. Third up, you've got love and belonging, family, friendship, sexual intimacy. Finally, or next up, you've got esteem, which is self-esteem, confidence, etc. And finally, self-actualization, which is where morality, creativity, spirituality comes into play. Now, I think there's a web design hierarchy of needs as well. And this isn't going to be very happy to those of you who are designers in the room. Because what is the absolute primal, primitive thing you need for web design? I'll give you a hint, it's not design. It's content and navigation. In order for your site to exist, in order for your site to be something that users want to come to, users need to have content they want and be able to get to the content they want. Next, they need a well-defined information architecture and predictability. What this means is, while content and navigation is nice, being able to know where content lives in relation to other content and being able to predict not only how content will show up, but how it will be displayed and how they can get to it is very important. Without this, a user feels lost. Next step up is performance. Performance is a design constraint. If you don't think performance is a design constraint, try going to, what is it? There's an Oakley website that weighs in now at a sleek 58 megabytes on mobile. or in general, but on mobile as well. If your user isn't able to actually use your site because your site's too slow for them to use, you're not serving them. Next up is esteem, branding. Once you have content and performance and predictability and navigation figured out, only then do you start on things like your branding. And really, your branding should come from those things. They should come from, they should spring from your content. On the web, or sorry, in print, the core of your branding was graphics. On the web, the core of your branding now is really typography and relations between between headers and paragraphs and lists and other items on the page. It's colors, it's typography. That's what your branding is on the web, and that's what you need to design first. And then after you have that, then you can start adding in flary things like animations and social media. But that stuff is the very last thing you need on your website in order for your website to be functional, in order for your website to be a thing users want to use. Everything else needs to be covered first. Users come to your content, come to your site for your content. So you should design your content first. Your content on your site needs to be predictable in order to be useful. Your site needs to be fast and reliable in order to be usable. You need a style that will reflect your branding and can be carried from your content up. Only after all other needs have been met should you focus on visual flair. In fact, visual flair should not negatively affect any of the other needs. If it does, you need to go back and fix that. While designers like having absolute control because they come from print, the realities of the situation on the web are there are real life constraints that we need to deal with. And these constraints will constrain the designs that are able to be effectively produced and work as effective websites on the internet as it currently stands. Do not run away from these constraints. These constraints are very important because these constraints are what produce fabulous websites. Let your design flow from your content. Let your users flow around your site. Tend to any rocks in your stream and be fluid as water. What does this mean? Anyone have an idea what this means? Has anyone gotten a Photoshop file of a homepage with what your guess is a carousel, and what you guess is some related content, and then a navigation, and then three other pieces of navigation, and then one that looks kind of clicked with a mega menu underneath it, and something that you're guessing is a link? Yeah? Have you ever gotten a second page for that document, and the sidebar is a different size? What happens when a title is longer than the one that they put into their Photoshop document? What happens when it's the same title and it's still too long because kerning in Photoshop and kerning on the web are different? The page metaphor is killing the web. It is us treating the web like paper, and the web is not paper. Instead, what we need to do is we need to build systems of style. We need to build them in browser with the tools of web design. HTML5. Fuck, I forgot that one. Whatever. We'll just skip it, I forgot it. So, we can employ modern web development tools to help us. First up, Yeoman. Who knows what Yeoman is? So, Yeoman is a fantastic tool written on top of Node.js. Yes, Node.js is a thing we're going to be talking about today. That allows you to easily generate new projects based on a template or based on some sort of standards. There are a couple great Yeoman generators out of the box. One of them is an Angular generator for building AngularJS items or websites. One of them is Web App, which I really dislike, but it's good if you like Twitter Bootstrap. Raise your hand if you like Twitter Bootstrap. Okay, you guys aren't allowed to be here anymore. Go away. No, it's okay. Twitter Bootstrap is a good example. Well, not a good example, but an existing example of what Twitter's style guide-ish thing is. It's not, we'll get to why it's not great, or we won't really, but I'll show you how you can build your own, which is much more powerful. So Yeoman is a tool to help easily kickstart projects. Who knows what Grunt is? Fantastic. If you want a deeper dive into Grunt, tomorrow there is a buff called Pig-powered presentation that I'm going to be going over how to add Grunt to your Drupal theming workflow. But what Grunt is another Node.js tool. Grunt is a task runner. So when building your websites, when building your themes, who remembers to minify all of your images? Who remembers to sprite everything? By the way, y'all should be looking around at how few hands are up. Who remembers to JS hint all of their JavaScript? Who CSS lints all their their CSS? Who does all of those things? Well, then you don't have to be here. So what Grunt does is Grunt allows us to create tasks that will do all this without us really thinking. We can just kind of have a thing running in the background saying, whenever I save a JavaScript file, run it through JS hint, and if it fails, yell at me. Run it through CS lint, and if it fails, yell at me. Run my CSS, or after I've saved my CSS, hey, why don't you live reload my browser so I can see what my CSS looks like without refreshing my page or getting rid of any of my AJAX states or generally any of that other stuff that really sucks when you're trying to style. You can also set it up to do some pretty cool things, which I'll get to a little bit later. Bower. Who knows what Bower is? Still in the back. So what Bower is Bower is a front-end package manager created by Twitter that's designed to easily pull in projects from either Bower, master repository thing, kind of like Ruby Gems or NPM, as well as GitHub, to allow you to manage dependencies without needing to put all of your dependencies into your GitHub repo and into the repository you're working on. So, for instance, if you were to create, I don't know, a Drupal module that needed a third-party thing that you can't actually install because of the GPL2 license, you could have a Bower RC file, or a Bower.json file, I should say, in your module and have the install instructions be Bower install, and then they'll download everything, and they'll get it without you needing to manage the dependencies. It's also really good for front-end stuff because you can pull in a ton of things, ranging from a responsive indicator, which I'm going to show you a little bit later, all the way through full Twitter Bootstrap and AngularJS and anything you want under the sun, really. So it's super duper powerful front-end dependency management tool. Sass. Who uses Sass? Oh, so you do know who I am. Who uses less? Oh, so you don't know who I am. So Sass is a CSS preprocessor. I would give you lots of reasons that Sass is the best of the available CSS preprocessors, but I'm also running the first Sass conference, so I think I'm a little bit biased. That being said, Sass is the best of the CSS preprocessors, and you should be using it. Sass does a lot of great things out of the box. It does things like extendable classes, which we're going to be diving into fairly heavily shortly. Mixins, it does functions, it has variables. Actually, before I continue, who doesn't use a CSS preprocessor? Okay, so most of you already do, and I don't need to give you the spiel about why you should be using one. For those actual three of you in this room who don't, you'll find out really shortly why. So Sass. And along with Sass, we're also going to use Compass, because Compass provides us with a framework for pulling in Sass dependencies and Sass packages, for instance, grid systems and media query systems. And finally, handlebars. Who has ever used handlebars? handful of you, who has been following Twig in Drupal 8? Who knows what Twig is? Good, much more of you. Handlebars is kind of, sort of, similar to a JS version of Twig. It has a very similar syntax. Handlebars just happens to work really well for style prototypes, which is why I've included handlebars in there. So, speaking of style prototypes, that's what we're working with, style prototypes. Now that's hard to read, but it's also gonna be in all of your command lines soon, so that should be exciting. So, style prototypes are a tool for designing style systems in browser from the content out. Style prototypes require Node.js, Ruby with Ruby gems, and Git to get started. I'm going to attempt to get you guys working with style prototypes by the end of this, but if you don't have these installed already, you're gonna have a bad time. So, if you're on an Apple computer, you're lucky, because you already have Ruby gems installed. If you're a developer in here, which I'm assuming most of you are, you probably also already have Git installed. The one thing that you may not have installed is Node. Node, very fortunately, has a nice GUI installation from its website, nodejs.org. While I'm talking, I would suggest you try and install it so you can be ready to play along at home. For those of you who do have this all installed, and we will go over this again once we're done with the little question, or once we're done with the little demo part of this, before we move into the actual hands-on stuff, this is the command for installing everything you need. You're gonna need yeoman installed, which is yo, grunt CLI, which is grunt command line, bower, winery, which we'll get to in a moment, and generator style prototype. Setting up a style prototype is very easy. All right, you're also gonna need bundler installed for Ruby. Gem install bundler. So, to get started with style prototypes, you type in yo style prototype. You get this nice little thing in your command line. It's gonna ask you some questions. It's gonna ask you for the name of your client, because we're building this for our client. It's gonna ask for the client's URL. It's gonna ask for the author's name. It's gonna ask for the author's email address. And then you're gonna run grunt server and magic will happen. So, are you guys ready for some magic? Yeah. Is everyone online? If you're not online, raise your hand. If you're not online, you're gonna have a bad time with this next part. Everyone, assuming that I actually have this up and running, which I hope I do. I do. Go to snugug.ircmaxl.com:8000. On anything you have with you, on your computer, on your mobile device, although it may have a couple bugs on its mobile device, because iOS 7 is weird, and Android's weird too. All mobile devices are weird. Go to snugug.ircmaxl.com:8000. Hopefully this will work. I haven't ever actually tried it with this large of an audience before, and it's being routed through a server, so we'll hope. Oh, lots of people connected. I can see the matrix. So, everyone should now have something that looks a little bit like this. Yes, no, maybe so. If you're able to connect, it should look something like this. If you're not able to connect, just watch the screen. So, who here has ever been told that the client needs to see the mocks? The client needs to see paper because the client needs to be able to decide what it looks like on paper before you get started. Yeah? As my head of process, Adam Ash, likes to say, a picture isn't requirements. And I tend to agree. You know what I tend to find makes really good requirements, though? things that are built. You know what I tend to find is a lot better than a picture? Going into someone's office, telling them to take out their phone, telling them to navigate to a website, and then playing with the styles they're working on and they're deciding on. You never, ever, 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 ever want a client to decide based on what they see in a printed paper. Why? It's a lie. Every Photoshop comp we've ever shown to a client is a lie. It's a convenient lie that we all agree is the kind of the truth. But it's a lie, and we all know it's a lie. Why do we know it's a lie? Because we've implemented these things. We know that whatever we got from Photoshop isn't actually what you're getting for a website. But it turns out, if what you show them is a website, it's no longer a lie, because it's something that actually exists, that they can use, that's written and built in HTML and CSS and JavaScript and works. This is now actually a useful deliverable. So, moving on to style prototypes. This is what you bring to your client. You bring your laptop and you bring nothing else. And you say, it wouldn't be ircmaxl.com. It would be your computer name. It will show you what it is. Go to this website. We're gonna go through this together. So right now, you all are my clients. And we're gonna go through the style prototype. So, the first page that you come to is actually not the first page you build when you start working with style prototypes. The first page is a style tile. Who is familiar with style tiles? Cool, so for those of you who are not, the website is styletile.es. They were created by a woman named Samantha Warren when she worked for Phase 2. And the idea of style tiles are when you're trying to get a look and feel of a site, you generally start with either mood boards or high-res comps. And mood boards are professional collages, is what they are. They're not very useful. At least I've never found them particularly useful. And high-res comps are totally the opposite of what we want. Remember, page metaphors are killing the web. What is a high-res comp? It is a page. So mood boards live somewhere in the middle. They have some headers, or they have some typography, some links, some colors, some possible patterns. Possible patterns, and I will stress this, possible patterns are not high-res comps put into a style tile. They are patterns. They are things like, I want the website to feel dark, so you take pictures of dark wood and put them in there. Or you take pictures of the night sky and put them in there. They are inspirational patterns for what you're trying to accomplish. They are not placeholders for high-res comps. What are they? They are not placeholders for high-res comps. They've got some buttons on there, and this down at the bottom, because they're not styled, because this isn't styled yet, are what we are adjectives and verbs describing the what they want the look and feel to be. So this is going to require some extra work. It's going to require you to interview your client and ask them, like, if you were a car, what kind of car would you be and why? And they would say something like, well, we're American, so we'd be a Dodge pickup truck, because America. And then you would say, strong and tough, and you'd put that there, because I think that's the copyrighted catchphrase that I'm stealing. And you would build this style tile and build this branding look and feel based on those adjectives and those verbs. But you might be saying, branding is fourth on the list of things you need. And I would say, you are correct. How do we get 1 through 3? This is how we get 1 through 3. Who here knows what content strategy is? Hey, guess what, everyone? You've accidentally stumbled into a content strategy talk. So, design is fabulous, but like my head of process, Adam, says, pictures are not requirements. Let's talk about content strategy for a little bit. Why do people come to your site? said this earlier, this shouldn't be a trick question. And yes, please call out, because this is the interactive portion of the show. Yes, people come to your site for your content. People come to your site for your content, why would you start the design process by drawing a picture of something that's not your content, and in fact, putting in nonsense words where your content would be? Except when it doesn't. So, why, yes, there is the old adage, a picture is worth 1,000 words. What are those 1,000 words? Those 1,000 words are, my site needs to be 960 pixels wide and red, and it needs a left sidebar, and it needs a carousel, because carousels are the best part of web design. When you start with a picture, the words that you're getting are about the picture. They are not about what the picture is meant to represent. And what the picture is meant to represent is a single display of your content. But whenever we go to do those pictures, we put in ipsum. Doesn't matter what flavor of ipsum, it can be lorem ipsum, it can be hipster ipsum, it can be Fillerama, it can be Monty Python ipsum, doesn't matter. It's ipsum, it's not real content. What we need to start with is we need to start with our content. We need to start with content strategy. Now, there are two big parts to content strategy. The first part is your goal. Why are you building this website? What is the purpose of this website? The reason that this is important for any project, as the very first thing you do as part of the design process, is you need to understand the point of what you're doing. The goal, there needs to be some sort of stated goal that you are working towards while you're designing in order for you to know when you're done. Because if you just start designing things and working on things until the client is finished fiddling, then you're gonna blow all your budget and your client's not actually gonna get what they want. So by insisting that you start with a goal statement for the design process, the redesign process, whatever you're working on, you are going to ensure that there is a point that you can work towards or a definition of done. The next thing you need to do, and the reason it's a million lines of code and not reading, or a million lines of text and not reading it word for word, is when you install a style prototype, it comes with this and you can read this because it's a reference, and I find that this reference is very useful. So don't worry about the exact words. So the next thing you need to do is you need to do a content audit. Who here has ever done a content audit for any of their clients? Ever. 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 One hand. One hand in this room. How do you know what's valuable? How do you know what you should be spending time on during the redesign process or the design process, if you have no idea what your content is? Why do users come to your site? Why do users come to your site? If you have no idea what your content is, what's valuable on your site, what's not valuable on your site, how will you ever know what to build? A content audit provides an overview of this. So, what is a content audit? Well, it's not content in the Drupal sense, so to speak. It's not just figuring out what content types you need for your nodes. It really is a kind of holistic approach to figuring out what is on your site. What types of images there are. Do you have images? What types of images are there? What metadata do you need for each one of those images in order to successfully display that image on a front end somewhere? What type of fields do you need for an article? But more important than all of that, why do you need an article? What's the benefit of having an article content type? What's the benefit of having an image? But not just that, what's the actual value of having an article content type? What's the value of images? What is the goal we're working towards with each one of these content types? So what we need to do is we need to not only take a look at what each of the different types of content are, And content, again, includes not just your node content types or your image and your media, but also includes things like your taxonomy and your users. Your users are a type of content on your site. They include ways that you group things. Media galleries are a type of content with related content. Carousels are a type of content with related things. Each one of these you need to create benefit statements for and values for and assign values for. And from there you can see what is actually valuable and what you should be working towards building first. It will provide you with an overview of what are the most valuable pieces and what are the least valuable pieces, what you should be working on first, what you should be leaving towards later, and will provide you with an idea of what your information architecture should be. If no one ever clicks on anything that's not the first image in the carousel, you don't need a carousel. If no one ever clicks on your human interest stories, you don't need human interest stories. While we've been kind of spoiled by large screens recently, one of the great advantages to doing a full content audit is being able to determine what's actually important to your users. Because why do users come to your site? If users don't use your content, is it valuable? Good. So let's take a quick look at an example goal statement. This is a fake news program, a fake news website. This is not real. I stress this is not real. I appreciate the fact I work for NBC. This is not NBC News. This is not anything confidential. This is something I made up, entirely made up. So, goal. Today's fast-paced world, we need to be able to quickly and effectively deliver accurate and up-to-date information to our readers in an easy and cross-platform way. To accomplish this, we want to be able to provide a single interface that can be accessed from anywhere by our reporters to be able to easily write new articles and seamlessly distribute them across multiple platforms. That is an example of a goal statement. It provides a clear idea, or a roughly clear idea, of the direction we should be heading in with all of our features and the rough value that we're going to be looking to obtain from each one of our pieces of content. We're gonna want stuff that's up to date and accurate, and we're gonna want it to work cross-platform, and we're going to want our editors to be able to create cross-platform content easily as well, from anywhere that they may be. Let's take a look at an example article type. When I like doing content audits, I like to start with a description. What is this in human language? So what's an article? Short to long form text with possible accompanying images of recent factual stories or events. That's fine, that tells us generally the fluffy of what this thing is supposed to be. What's nice about writing out a description for everything is when you write out a description for everything, you'll start to see, hey, this and this have pretty much the same human readable description. Let's see why they're different items, different pieces of content. It might help you pare down the different types of content that you have to deal with on your site. Next up, benefit statements. Who here works in an agile process? Who here does benefit statements for each of their user stories? Who here should be doing benefit statements for each one of their user stories? Who here doesn't know what a benefit statement is? A benefit statement usually reads, as a thing, I would like a thing to thing, or because of thing. These aren't quite written with the because of thing. The because of thing is always hardest. So these are just kind of kept simple. So, benefits of an article. As a reader, I would like the most up-to-date information about the state of the world. So an article should provide that benefit to my reader. As a site owner, I would like to increase traffic to our site during peak news stories in order to enhance our standing as a world-leading news source. So, the benefits for this article should, the final product of this article, this piece of content, should work for the benefits of both of these groups of people, both the reader and the site owner. Let's take a look at value. Now, there are lots of different ways to calculate value. Value is really a business thing. You can calculate value anywhere from just straight how many page views some things get, all the way through some crazy complex math of page views versus advertising cost versus advertising revenue versus how long it actually took to build the whole thing and how much you spent. So everyone's values are going to be a little bit different, but the key is to assign value to everything. Because if you're able to assign value, then you're able to determine whether or not something is valuable. Kind of seems silly, and yes, I know I use the same word to define itself. But it's important. It's something we don't think about when we're getting feature requests. I want a media gallery. Why do you want a media gallery? What value does that bring? Well, people can see lots of pictures. Yeah, but that doesn't provide value. One of the things that I'm sure you've seen is people tend not to think that design and development cost anything until they get their bill, because we're building software. We're not building something physical that they can hold. And because of that, they don't value the time that it takes to build things very well. Not all stakeholders, but a lot of stakeholders don't really value that development is actually time consuming and costs money. If you're going to make a custom ad that's going to cost, that you're getting paid $15,000 for, but it takes three senior developers 3 weeks to build, is that valuable? Something that should be thought about. And by assigning value to each one of these, not just content, but to your features as well, it'll help you suss that out. So in this instance, we've decided to calculate value based on net ad revenue per year. So articles, on average, I'm making numbers up, get 25,000 page views a year, each individual article. A cost per ad is 10 cents per 1,000 units served. Revenue per ad per year is, or per article per year for the ads, is $450. So each article, according to this silly math, makes about $447 a year for the company. Okay, that's a number. Fantastic. The next step that we have, and we'll get back to that's a number, that's fantastic in a moment. Next thing that we have is we have fields. What actually is required to create this? Now, when thinking about this, we need to be thinking about this in a cross-platform, cross-device, front-end agnostic way. So, who here uses Path Auto? If you are a Drupal developer and you didn't raise your hand, you are a liar. Everyone uses Path Auto. Everyone knows how in Path Auto, it provides a field, I believe it's Path Auto that provides this field, that allows you to tell Drupal exactly what you want your URL for that piece of content to be. Everyone knows that field when you're creating a new piece of content in Drupal? Yes? Is that inherent to the content? Let me rephrase. Is the path that it sits on, is the path that the that a given article is available at, something that is intrinsically true to the metadata of that article? Or is it something that is true to the system that that article is being displayed on, displayed through? Which one? Is it A? It's B. Good. So when thinking about what fields are part of the content audit, we need to be thinking about fields that fall into the category A. Things that are display agnostic that are required to have this piece of content be something. things, you are going to need things, you're going to need rules for how to actually display it on multiple different, or on whatever device is ultimately displaying this content, but those are not things that belong in the content audit. Certainly not this form of the content audit. Those are things that are required to launch a site, and those could be requirements in the future to build this. We need these fields, plus we need the ability to be able to set the actual URL path. But the actual URL path is not something inherent to the content. What is inherent to the content as described in the benefit statement and the description? Let's read the description again. A short to long form text with possible accompanying images of recent factual stories. Benefits. As a reader, I would like the most up-to-date information about the state of the world. Site owner, I would like to increase traffic to our site during peak news stories in order to enhance our standing as a world-leading news source. So, we're going to have an article, and we're going to have something that people can read and talk about the state of the world. What do we need for that? And with potential images to go with it. Well, we need a title. How many titles can we have? We can have one title. Is it required? Yeah, it's required. It's a title. And what is the title? It's a descriptive title. Wow, I'm really terrible at defining things with their own word. Ignore that. It's a description. A title is ultimately a quick description of the content. We're going to say we're going to limit it to 127 characters. That's a business requirement for this field. Body, one, required. Long form text box that accepts plain text or markdown. Who thinks it should accept something else? What else should it accept? The one person in the room that thinks it should accept something else. So that's actually a very good point. But it's a very good point, but it's a point for something else. Yes, clients don't know how to write markdown. Does that say that clients need to write markdown? No. All that it says is the text box needs to accept plain text and markdown. We can choose to input the markdown with whatever we'd like. We can input it with WYSIWYG if you really, truly love WYSIWYG. You can input it through straight markdown. This doesn't tell you how. It only tells you what. And that's very important. We don't want implementation details that are not business requirements in this content audit. The 127 characters is a business requirement, so it can be part of the description. The fact that we want to use a WYSIWYG editor for body is irrelevant to the implementation, or is irrelevant to the core concept of what a body is. So we don't need that there. That being said, when you go to actually write the feature, the user story to create this feature, you could then say, implement a WYSIWYG editor that writes markdown, and then that would be fine. But just because a client doesn't know how to write markdown doesn't mean it can't be a business requirement. Savvy? What else do we need? Well, someone's going to be writing this. There should be an author attached to this, yes? Should the author be a text field? Should the author be a text field? Don't look at the screen. Should the author be a text field? No. Why shouldn't it be a text field? What if it's not a user? What if there is a user entity that is not a physical user in the Drupal sense? What if it's a piece of content? Writes more articles, right. So, one of the important things when working with content audits is you start to set up these relations between different pieces of content through words like reference. This is where your information architecture starts to come from. You start to get a shape and a look and a feel for what your site actually will be. So, why do we want references to an author instead of a plain text? Because references will allow us, no matter what device we're on, no matter how we're getting it, whether it be a mobile device or a JSON feed, to be able to reference deeper and dive deeper into the person who wrote it. And that's important. We need to be able to connect things together. That's the navigation part. Users need to be able to flow through your site. Publish date. This is going to get published. We are a news organization. When something was written is very important to us. So we need a publish date. Publish dates are required. Publish date is a date stamp. Could also be a reference to a date object. There are a bunch of different ways you can do this. This is something that you possibly is up to implementation, but it's a required date. Summary. What happens if you need a short summary and you can choose? So let me rephrase. Drupal, who uses Drupal's summary for the body field? Handful of you. Who knew that Drupal 7's body field had a summary? Why don't you use the summary? Don't like the behavior. Why else? Okay. Make your own. Okay. So, for the not wanting, making your own, not liking the behavior, that's fine. That's an implementation detail. Not wanting to fill in the same content twice, that's interesting. One of the things that content strategy tends to do, and especially when you're dealing with let me rephrase. Karen McGrain has a fantastic quote. Truncation is not a content strat. So, the reason that, and certainly in a breaking news story, the reason that a summary field would be something very important is we don't want truncated content. Truncated content is not a content strategy. We need to be able to provide a short description of what's going on without fumbling over ourselves. And that doesn't necessarily need to be the same content, just copied and pasted. What else did we need from description? We needed optional images, so we can have a primary image. A primary image, separating out a primary image from other images is good because then we have a way for us to grab the most important image and use it other places. Reference to an image entity. Related images, multiple, optional, reference to image entities. Related human interest story, because we want to drive traffic. Human interest stories drive traffic because humans like emotions. And taxonomy, multiple required, this is a way for us to link content around. Let me be clear about what I just showed you. This is not necessarily something that you should take and use and run with. This is something that I made up for an imaginary user and an imaginary client. But this is something that you should think about when working with your own. You might come to similar conclusions that I have, but don't necessarily use this verbatim. Human interest story, and this is where we get back to value. Human interest story, short to long form text with primary media and emotional stories. As a reader, I would like to connect to the people affected by events in the world. As a site owner, I would like to reduce bounce rate by providing additional engagement opportunities to readers. This has very, very clear benefits. This is, benefits should be something that should be measurable. Now, not necessarily something that we have measurements for right now, but goals for us to measure on a smaller basis than the overall goal. Human interest stories are a way to reduce bounce rate by getting people involved in the stories that they're talking about. They have page value per view, page value per year, blah, 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 the net ad revenue, that's what's important, $199 net ad revenue per year. This is where I said value is relative, right? So, blah, 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 what am I doing? 199 divided by 10,000 is about 2 cents for every page view. It's actually 1.99 cents per page view is the human interest story, is what the value of a human interest story is. real articles, full articles, despite the fact that they make more net ad revenue, they only make 1.8 cents per page view. So by actually using some analytics and some statistics to suss out the value of what you're doing, you will see fairly quickly, or you'll see fairly quickly that despite the fact that human interest stories make less actual money, they are more valuable because they produce more value for your client. So you should probably be working on them first. This is where content strategy affects design. It affects how you start to build things. Now, title requirements, yada yada. That's step one of design, content strategy. Now we're gonna get into actual design. Yay! If everyone will move over to elements, we'll start with things that the browser does really well. You know something that the browser does really well? Links. Who here has ever gotten a PDF without hover states for links? Yeah. Look, links with hover states, because it's the web. Who here is actually connected to this and can see it on their computers? Cool, a bunch of you. This is the one cool thing that designing in browser can do that no other design methodology can. If a client has a change while you're in the meeting, you can do it and show it to them before you leave. Yeah. On their device, nonetheless. What if I changed it to green? Is everyone looking? Watch yourself. Green. Ooh, pretty. So, a question before I continue. If I was your developer, or if I was in a pitch to you, and you're my clients, and I walk in and tell you to take out your phone, go to a website, and say, here, this is what some basic branding might look like for you. They say, I don't really like this. You change it for them on the spot while they're holding their phone in your hand. You think anyone else is going to be able to compete with that? No. You know what's even better about this? It's a new process. You can charge more. It takes longer. You can charge more. Yeah. Everything with a little bit of theater. So, back to what I was actually showing you guys. So, the first thing that we do when we start designing, and this is once we've done our content strategy, the first step of design, first step of actually building a physical design is to build an element guide. Who uses the style guide module? Handful of you. So, what the style guide module does, and what this does as well, is who has ever gotten to about 3 weeks before launch the client's finally putting content in, and the client realizes that all of the node body text isn't styled. Yeah? I know it's happened. It's happened to me a couple times. Raise your hand. Raise your hand. Yeah. Why that happens is because of pages and designing pages instead of designing systems. The content audit is a system. It is a system for determining value for you to start design. Building a style guide is a system for you to ensure that all of your base needs are met before you continue. Everything you have on your site starts as tags. Those tags should have some form of styling to them if they need styling. Header tags should have base header styling. Link tags should have base link styling. List tags should have basic link style, list styling. Who always forgets to style nested lists? Because you don't see them until a client does them. Because they're never on any page comps.
Talking about
Right. So nested list and mixed list, because mixed lists sometimes happen. Who here remembers to style each and every different form input type? Are you sure it's each and every one of them? Because they're a ton. What about content editable? Remember to do content editable too? It's not something that you might use a whole lot, but it's something that you're going to want to once you show a client. How about displays? Everyone styles tables. Who doesn't style tables because tables are never in the pages that they get? I know it's more than just the three people raising their hands, so I'm going to keep going. Forms with field groups, code blocks, mixed text, paragraphs with headers and everything. By building this all in browser, it makes it fairly easy for us to see what we're missing, what we're not missing, what goes together, what doesn't, and change it on the fly. Next up, components. Actually, we're going to do colors first. Nah, we'll do components first. Components. So, this is another example of systems over pages. Who here, I like this, who here has ever gotten two or more, or even multiple on the same page of a button? The buttons look like they should be the same, but are different sizes, or have different thickness borders, or have different thickness text. Yeah? What about navigation? That happens more than it should, doesn't it? Why does it happen more than it should? Because we're not designing components. Because when we work in Photoshop, we work on a page instead of working in systems. What components allow us to do, and what designing components allow us to do, is break down small little pieces that have repeated patterns. Patterns for our system. These patterns allow us to design things similarly with a set of HTML that we then don't have to go and remember or forget or mess around with, and we don't have fucking two buttons being 3 pixels different and needing to have 2 different button styles because we need pixel perfect designs. So, there's some accessibility things. We generally don't need to deal with accessibility when working in Drupal because Drupal actually does accessibility pretty well, but something like messages. This is a status message. Who knows that the status message actually has an H2 in it in Drupal? Like 2 of you, 3 of you. What about the fact that every other one of the messages do as well? They all have what type of message they are. By displaying our components out visually and providing source, HTML source and Sass source, we're able to quickly and easily see what a component should look like in HTML. And we're able to see how we can style it as well. We can choose to either style it with the classes that it provides, or, and this if you're not familiar with Sass is going to look a little bit weird, @extend. @extend is a concept in Sass that allows you to essentially create comma-separated selectors out of thin air. So I have, it's the best way to describe it is I've actually styled this, I promise, but it's not going to exist until you tell me you want it to exist. So .message.status doesn't get any of its styling from CSS written here. It gets styling from this extendable class. Go take a look at the extendable class. It's extend status. So if we take a look at status, status says I want to include message colors with CSS status. That's a mixin. We have mixin source. So message colors, and we're going to pass in a color. And then that's all the craziness that prints it out. Now, while this looks kind of big and imposing right now, It actually is a fairly convenient way. Open extends. Of looking at the mixins and the extendables for our buttons without needing to dive into source code, without needing to dive into the actual system, which means that we can publish this style guide somewhere when we're done, separate from our source code, and have it as a permanent reference for what we're doing, which makes this a much more valuable deliverable than a PDF could ever hope to be. This provides a system for someone to go and reuse what we're building outside of the project that we're building. That provides extra value to your customer, and it allows you to, again, charge more because they're getting more out of you. But that's not just true for the Sass. Open. Boink yourself. Comments, buttons, button. Button, big button. I wanted messages, didn't I? Sorry, give me 1 second. It also provides us with the HTML. So the HTML that is here, and the HTML that is here, is both being pulled in from this HTML file, which means if we change something here, it will update there. But really, we wouldn't want to change an individual thing. We might want to change, stop, go away. Components message. So, what we really want to change is the template that makes up our component. Components are derived from a template with a couple different options added into them, but basically all components are the same set of markup with just different options, because that's what components are. So if I wanted to add foobar here, all of my components get updated with the new piece of HTML that makes them exist. Now we can see how they exist, we can see where they come from, and it makes it a lot easier to actually work with components and think in a system, and think in components, because we've got a template that we can just pass the different pieces into. And that's very powerful for working with components and working and building systems. Last thing that we can do inside of style prototypes, inside of the actual website, is a color guide. Everyone forgets to build a bulk color guide. Or, like if you were me in my previous position, get a color guide done entirely in Pantone colors, because Pantone exists on the web. So, a color guide allows us to quickly and easily see variables with their hex value for reference inside and outside of web design. Different shades, different tints. And actually, this entire thing is built based off of one color. It's a single color, and Sass can generate all these colors for us. So we can start designing using color theory in browser. It's not something just relegated to Photoshop. And then at the end of the day, because if you're in here, you probably know who I am. Everything is responsive. So not only do you get to go to your client with something that you can update quickly, provide a system for, but you can also do it across any of their devices. And you're actually building things for all of their devices at once, and you're designing for all devices at once, and all web interfaces really is what it is, at once, which is super powerful. You're not coming to them with a static comp. What's the first thing you do when you open up a Photoshop file to start working? You need to set a width. You need to set a height. That's the antithesis of what we're doing on the web. This is meant to be fluid. Any questions about style prototypes? Oh, there's one more thing. One more thing. If I were to have a collar on. Oh. You all probably just lost your connection. Yes, I'm aware. I'm going to show you why in a second. Command line. Ooh, those colors are terrible. So, at the end of the day, we can do this. Grunt extension. See this thing that's been generated right here? That is a compass extension. Who knows what compass extensions are? Those of you who don't, compass extensions are packaged gems that include some Sass, but also can include images and JavaScript and fonts and files. If you ever had a problem of getting all of your developers on the same page with the same style, the deliverable that you get from style prototypes, besides the page that provides you all the look and feel, is you get a compass extension that can literally be dropped onto any computer and have anyone working with your style system without any, with essentially three lines of code. Gem install that. Compass install that. And then they have not only your full style guide to work with, basically every single one of the styles you built for all of the components and all of the elements, they have all of that to work with. They have all of your variables, all of your colors. By installing, they get all of the images that you've used, all of the JavaScript that you've used, all of the fonts that you've included in your style prototype, your CSS linting, your JavaScript hinting, your editor config, your gem file to make sure that all of your developers' versions are the same for each and every gem, so you don't have issues of updating something and all of your styling breaking. All of this with one line of code. That is probably the biggest thing that you get from style prototypes. It's not the style prototypes. It's not necessarily even the content strategy. The content strategy it doesn't really do, but things that style prototypes actually physically give you, this is probably the greatest one, because it's how you move from a style prototyping system, a style guide system, into an actual project. This can be used in Drupal. This can be used in WordPress. This can be used in Joomla. This can be used on Rails. This can be used in Node. This can be used on static sites. By packaging your full style guide as a compass gem, it can be used anywhere that compass can be used, which is any web property you're working on. That is lasting value outside of the single site that you're building. That, in my opinion, is quite powerful. And again, another thing you can charge for. So, with that, are there any questions? I'm going to grunt server. Yes. So the way that we work is we have designers working on style prototypes and developers working on Drupal. When a component gets created, after it's been through the whole agile process of figuring out what its requirements are, HTML can be put into the style prototype inside of a component. Designers can style it. And the next iteration, designers commit their code into here. They've styled that component with the HTML provided by them. And then a developer just needs to pull in the new version of the gem and recompile, and they have all the new designs. It's that easy. It doesn't sound easy because it's, oh, designers just need to learn how to code. Designers need to learn how to code. If you don't have designers that can code, what I have done in the past and what we do at work is we actually, who here is familiar with pair programming? We do pair design. We sit a designer next to a developer. The developer is their hands, and the designer is the eyes. It takes about 5 days for the designer to say, give me the keyboard I want to code. And then we get designers learning how to code. Now, I'm not necessarily advocating for designers to learn all of the intricacies of cross-browser development, cross-browser front-end, or all the intricacies of JavaScript. But basic HTML and basic CSS are very powerful tools. Even just basic HTML and CSS3 is really what they should have, are very powerful tools. They can get very far with them. And then anything else is something that the developer can work on. Any other questions? Any other questions? Fantastic, yes. Yeah, sure. Actually, I totally can do that. So, here is my gem, style prototype presentation style guide. I'm going to do left and make that this so I can actually see what's going on. Ready? This is the entire process of getting in. Well, I'm going to create a Drupal theme right now. Who here has used Aurora or knows what Aurora is? So Aurora is the base theme that I maintain. Building sub-themes for Aurora is the matter of running a compass command. So I'm just going to create a sub-theme of Aurora right now. Test. Whoops. I need to install my gem first. Forgot to do that. I'm sorry. Give me a second. Anyway, while that's being downloaded from the internet, what we do is we do gem install style prototype presentation style guide 000.gem. What that will do is that will install this gem to my local Ruby repository for gems and goodness. And that means that I can then start using it in projects. The gem install process takes a moment. Give me a second.
So the way that works is it's installing from what's in that directory?
Yes. Yes. Come on, Ruby. Come on, Ruby. Come on, Ruby. Whatever. Okay. We're in a brand new sub-theme called, or we're in a brand new theme called Foo. Oh, see, it has an info file. It's totally a new theme. Both being super duper slow. I'm not happy. There we go. Okay. Compass, create test. There we go. Now a real sub theme. So, I'm inside of a sub-theme. It's a real theme. The Aurora themes come with template PHP and info file, a config.rb file, a gem file for handling dependencies, Sass stuff, the compiled style sheets. There's nothing up my sleeve. This has essentially nothing in it. It's got the border box fix in it. It's got image and video fluid stuff in it. And it's got clear fix in it. That's all that the style. That's all that is in style.scss right now. Or CSS right now, I should say. Installing. Yay, that's finally installed. So I can open up config our blah blah blah. Open config rb. And I can do, I'm going to copy it from here so I don't misspell it. Require with an S, style prototype presentation style guide. So I'm requiring the style guide gem that I built in config RB. What? I totally do. Thank you. Open gem file. Inside of my gem file, I'm going to do gem style prototype 0.0.0 because that's the version. I'm going to run bundle install. This shouldn't yell at me because I have the gem installed locally. Oh, I know why that is. Huh? Ignore that. That's a bug. I need to fix that. Anyway, so open config RB. We can do it without that. So gem install style prototype. Or not gem install, compass install. Yes, compass and grunt are different things. So, it's created images, patterns, it's created JavaScript's directory for me, it's put a bunch of JavaScript stuff in, it's put pattern stuff in, it's put bower.json in. Open bower.json. And look, these are all the things that I need. So I can do bower install and pull in all of my bower dependencies. We have formalized pulled in. We've got jQuery pulled in, modernizer, prism, responsive indicator, and element details polyfill. So bower bringing in all of our dependencies into straight into our theme. If we go to cd sass, cd partials, cd global, open base, what I'm going to do is I'm going to import style prototypes presentation style guide. So really the two things you need to do is the config and this import. Now I can do remove. What are you doing? Sorry, there's an error somewhere. Uh-oh. Found an error during a presentation. That's never good. That's why you don't live code. Anyway, once I get that bug fixed, it's as simple as that. You could use Grunt if you had Grunt set up to generate a subtheme. But Grunt Compass is a system for Sass and for gems, and it has a feature built in to create templates. Grunt, you need to write all of your Grunt tasks on your own, and Grunt doesn't have a global state like Compass does. So you could write a Grunt task that lives in your themes folder that will generate sub-themes for you, but I don't really see why. So, I found a bug that I need to go fix, but trust me, when this bug is fixed, it's as easy as that. Oh, crap, I know why. I renamed something and forgot to change something. Ha ha. We can actually fix that. I'm not going to fix it right now. Any other questions? And then we're going to try and get everyone installed. Yep.
So
Yep. Yeah, so the question was, if I get this wrong, stop me. We have collaboration between designers and front-end developers. Does that also mean we have collaboration between developers and other front-end developers for markup? Yeah? Front-end developers and front-end developers, or front-end developers and back-end developers? Front-end and back-end? So when we... Yes and no. Drupal's... Yes. Right. So templates that are in style prototypes, the HTML that are in style prototypes, the component templates, those are the way that we work is if a, or the way that we should be working once we get more developers on board with this, is having that HTML be canonical URL. So be canonical HTML. It's the front end developer's domain expertise to write to determine markup. So if a module is being produced by a back-end developer and they need markup for it, they should, and they do, we do have actually some collaboration between back-end developers and front-end developers. Back-end developers do not make markup decisions, front-end developers make markup decisions. If it's for a component that's been added to the style prototype, the back-end developer should have the style prototype, open up the style prototype, see what the HTML is, and use that HTML. If it's something that's coming from Drupal, it's up to the front-end developer to change Drupal's markup to match the prototype, or to change the prototype to match the markup they're getting. The front-end developer is the glue between the two sides. They're the ones that are determining the markup, and if determining the markup for the style prototype components, and if the markup coming out of Drupal can't or is really significantly hard to match that, changing the markup in the prototype and then the designer working on it. One really important thing to note about this process, which I hope went without saying, is this process does not work in Waterfall. Waterfall is not a process for web design. Waterfall is a process for graphic development and print design. You need to work agilely. You need a single designer or whatever team of designers start a project, be able to see a project all the way through. It cannot be a split resource. Developers aren't a split resource, designers shouldn't be a split resource either. They need to be part of the development team, work on the same agile cycle as everyone else. Design needs to happen in conjunction with development. Yep. So the question is, or the statement is, once the initial design is complete, the style prototype doesn't get maintained and then falls to the wayside. And the answer to that is, the style prototype should not be not maintained. This is the design and development happen simultaneously for the entire lifetime of the project. And if there needs to be a new component added, that component needs to go through the style prototype process. So there should be no point where the style prototype is no longer maintained. Style prototype is useful for the entire length of the project, from discovery through delivery, and through additional feature requests thereafter. One of the things that you may have noticed or may not have noticed is there's a version number right here. All designs get a version number. At the end of a sprint, you bump the version number. So you know what version of the gem is on, or you know what version you're on. When you bump the version number, the gem version changes as well. So it is a way to provide some sort of continuity between different versions and understand that this is a living document and not a static document that stopped at version 000. Anything else? Yeah. The sub-theme does not get generated from the style prototype. The sub-theme gets generated from the Compass Aurora Compass extension. Yes, Aurora has documentation on that. Yes, there is lots of documentation on that. Sorry? Thank you. It's also pretty documentation. Yeah, so there is documentation for Aurora and creating sub-themes with Aurora. Yes. Anything else? No, good, awesome. So we've got 30-ish minutes. I wish I could turn the lights on. I would like everyone to try to get style prototypes installed and get your first prototype running. I'm going to put that slide back up. Safari is what I want. And then you can leave here with something working. So, thank you, let's get you installed. Lights. I want lights. Are there lights in the back? Or is it just curtains and we'll just open all the curtains? Let's open all the curtains. Light. Okay, awesome. So, now that there's light, we're gonna need it's dark up front. Dashes are this terrible blue. I'm sorry. There we go. So, if you'd like to stick around and get style prototypes installed, please do. If not, feel free to leave. Thank you. If you are going to leave, I've been told to remind you, and really everyone else, that these presentations need ratings. Go to the schedule / the presentation name, and then at the bottom there's gonna be a rate thing, rate the presentation so they can know how to do it in the future. So, thank you. So, if you are not on an Apple computer, raise your hand. If you are, and so for those of you not on Apple computers, are you on Linux computers or Windows computers? Linux computers, raise your hand. Windows computers, raise your hand. Windows computers, do you already have, if you have Windows computers, what you should do, go to nodejs.org or .com, I forget which one it is, install Node.js. Also go to rubyinstaller.org and install Ruby. Make sure you've got Git installed. Linux users, make sure you, Linux and Apple users, make sure you've got Git installed. Linux users, go to, no, where's Google Chrome? / musings. What is it? I don't remember what it is. Google is always how you find your own stuff. So, Linux computers. You can't read that any better, can you? snugug.com/musings/installing-sass-and-compass-across-all-platforms. Yay. Sorry? For Linux, for Unix. That's for Unix. What I'm gonna do, actually, go to github.com, much better. github.com/team-sass/generator-style-prototype. Everyone go there. This is the easier way to do installation. Everyone go there. In the README, the very first thing in the README is requirements with links. So if you follow those links, it will get you to set up on your various different operating systems. And then you run this line. So everyone try that. If you get stuck, raise your hand, and I will come help. And I will put the URL up. Yep. Right, so that is an issue that's inherent to browser and we can't solve. It is an issue in, it's actually only an issue in Safari and Mobile Safari. It's no longer, it's, yeah, that's the issue. There is no workaround. I'd be okay with things not being pixel perfect. Yeah, so pixel perfect is a thing that doesn't exist when talking about fluidity. And it's something that just can't exist when talking about fluidity, especially when dealing with the realities of the web, which is cross browsers and browsers rendering things differently. They can't have it. The entire purpose of have them read the DAO of web design. The truth of the matter is the web is not print. You cannot treat it like print. And pixel perfect is a thing. One of the ways to mitigate the compounding issue of some pixel rounding is to use the isolation output method for singularity, which doesn't have items float next to each other, which won't compound that issue. But there is no way to make it pixel perfect in all browsers. It's just, it's not a thing that's a reality. You're welcome. How's everyone doing with that? Good. If you have issues, raise your hand. If you are finished, raise your hand. Okay, so if you're finished, go down to the next line, creating a style prototype in your command line. Go somewhere and do yo space style dash prototype. You should get something that. Yo, style. You should get something that looks a little bit like that. And then just follow these questions, press enter, 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 once you've written out all the answers to these questions, and then you should have a style prototype. And when you're done with that, run grunt serve. When you're done with that, cd into the directory and do grunt server dash dash launch. If you're on an Apple computer, don't do dash dash launch. If you're not on an Apple computer, don't include dash dash launch. And then you'll just need to go to localhost. Yep. I had this problem yesterday with someone. intro command line. If you are on Windows and you're having issues, go here. snugug.github.io/I intro-C command-L line. One of the slides is setting up this stack on a Windows computer. Essentially what you're gonna need to do is after you have everything installed, you're going to need to download a program called Console 2. Have Console 2 work through PowerShell, and then everything will be happy. You'll be able to use Unix-style commands while navigating around Windows and have a single console with everything available to it, which is happy, happy. But it's a little bit more complex working with Windows in the command line. So, for those of you who were able to successfully install style prototypes and able to successfully get it running, if you were able to successfully install and get style prototypes running, raise your hand. Cool. If you were able to successfully install but not get running, raise your hand. What errors were you guys getting? Still hanging. Oh, internet. Fantastic. So for those of you who have it running, play around. If you have questions, ask me. I'm here for another 20 minutes. If you have questions in general, yeah. It's localhost colon 8000. You're on Windows? So if you're on Windows, go to this URL. And this URL is introduction to the command line, and all of the code written in there works on. You can use git bash. Right, so what you need is you need a shell on Windows that has access to Node, Ruby, and Git. And git bash or Ruby bash don't have access to the other ones. So you need to run it through console 2 and PowerShell, and that's how you get access to everything. How's everyone doing? Still hanging? I love internet working so well at internet conferences. Looks like Emma got it. Break on through to the other side. I'm gonna play music. Yeah? Yeah. Oh, well then, I'm not gonna play music. So the style prototype, we ran Grunt extension inside the style prototype. It created a compass extension for us. And then we did gem install that compass extension that installed it to our computer. Then inside of our subtheme, in our config.rb file, we added that gem. The way that you add compass extensions into a Compass program in order to run it and use it is by adding it to your config.rb file. And then we just started using it. So the subtheme, when you do import name style guide, that brings in all the CSS. And then all the Sass that you wrote in the style prototype, all that styling that you've done, it brings it in, and then you can just start using it right away. Yeah. Yep. And all of the component styling that you have in there will be available. So if you have components marked up, All of that will get themed right away. Any element theming just happens. It all gets pulled in automatically. This is the workflow that I use, yeah. Yeah. Yep. Yep. You're welcome. What's up? Do you have it installed? Did you run Grunt server inside of the folder that got created when you did Yo style prototype? So once you have Yo style, once you have a style prototype created, you need to cd into that folder and run Grunt server. Grunt server will start the server, start everything working, start everything rocking. One of the things that I did not cover, but is a little added bonus, is if you open up config.yaml under server, there are two options. There is a port number, which is a port number, and then there is remote access being true or false. The way that you were all able to access the style prototype running off of my computer is by having remote access enabled. That is how you go to clients and tell them to go to this URL and have it work. And when you turn remote access on, it will tell you what URL you can go to. It'll tell you it using a host name, which should work. The reason we didn't use it off of host names today is because this internet is terrible, and it blocked it, and it's all sorts of crap. But it should work, and it works whenever I'm developing. The other thing is you can use that when you're developing. When you turn remote access on, two windows will open. Your style prototype will open, and it's called Winery, W-E-I-N-R-E, window will open at port 8002. That one might not work the first time, you just need to refresh the page and it will work again. What that is remote debugging. So you can have a bunch of devices open and be styling across all of those devices at once, having them all live reloading based on you saving. And then if you need to inspect an element on a specific device, that what will be open is essentially WebKit's inspector, and you'll be able to choose what device you want to work with and be able to edit stuff on that device. So it's remote debugging built into remote view, remote access. So I could have gone to any one of your devices that were connected to me earlier and changed stuff just for you. Style prototypes, yeah. So there are lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of documentation here. Lots and lots and lots of documentation. It actually needs to be updated because it's about two versions behind because I've pushed out two versions of this in the past 2 weeks. There's also Designer's Quick Start Guide. So if you're a designer and you've never worked with this stack before and you've never worked with Git before, this is a quick start guide for getting you up to speed-ish with HTML and CSS and installing things, et cetera, code editing tools, stuff like that. So lots of documentation. Oh, yeah, the evil maniacal laughter tweet. That was the remote viewing and remote access. Yeah. Any other questions? People have it running? If you don't have it running, raise your hand. Lower your hand if it's because of the internet. Okay. Raise your hand if it's not because of the internet. Do you have an error in your... So there's a task in there that is ongoing. Thank you. Anyone else? So if you have it running and you have questions, feel free to ask them. If not, we've got 10 minutes left. You can filter out whenever you'd like. Yeah, what's up? Yeah, absolutely. So, open this. Mouse. So, this is what a style prototype looks like. Generally, what you're going to change is if you need to need a new Bower component, you would edit Bower.json and add a new component, then run Bower install again. Config.yaml has a bunch of configuration options. This controls your navigation. This controls what components exist. Sublime text, preferences, color scheme, lazy. There we go. That wasn't what I wanted to open. That's what I wanted to open. So this is what config.yaml looks like. You've got your client information up here. You've got your author information. You can set logo to false or true, and it or false or a path, and then your name changes to the path, or name changes to the logo. Typekit ID, if you use Typekit, I use Typekit for all my web fonts, so I have Typekit ID, you can also do Google Web Fonts. Sections, those are your main nav. Style tile options, how many different colors you want. The URLs to the different image patterns, and what the keywords are. Components, you've got messages, buttons, these are the different types of components. If I am running, no, away with you. Grunt server is running. So if I have components here and I want to create a new component, say a quote, and I save that, Grunt will create for me, inside of templates, components, it will create a quote template for me for my component. There's nothing in here yet. It will also create partials, components, prototype group quote, as well as the different different individual types of component. If I were to go in here and I would do clock quote, hello, Grunt will say, hey, look, you've changed something. And now that HTML has been generated. Yep. Magic. It's magic. That's all I'm gonna say. So here, it's created pull, hello pull, and hello block. The real answer is I wrote a Grunt command to do all this. It took about a week's worth of time to get it all working correctly. But I wrote a Grunt command. And the Grunt command actually, if you wanna see what the Grunt command looks like, Grunt file is the brains of everything. You probably don't want to edit it, but you can look at it. It's somewhat long. This is the command that creates components. All that. It does the other thing that it did, which I will show you, is inside of Sass components, it created a quote Sass file for me with the imports, with the if stuff, so you can choose whether or not you want selector's output, the different quote blocks to get all of the quotes pulled, to get the Sass pulled into the HTML on the front end. It created the folder with the extended mixin, so it sets a lot of stuff up for you when you create a component this way. So what you're generally going to be looking to edit are your config YAML file, images, JavaScript. You can edit pages if you'd like. There's no reason not to. And obviously all of your Sass. And the templates, the component templates. The next step for this is going to be adding in prototyping. So you can prototype layouts and you can include layout. You will be able to include layouts as part of your style prototype, your style guide. And then you can just kind of drop those in and magically have layouts when you drop it in. You can use whatever you'd like. I recommend Singularity. So style prototypes live outside of Aurora, but if you follow the workflow of something gets built in style prototypes, at the end of your sprint, you generate a new compass extension, you pull the new compass extension into your working theme, and then continue the next sprint from there, then the new compass extension will have that stuff in it. Yep. You add it to config RB, you add require, and then whatever the name is. You're probably going to also need to add it to your gem file if you're running through a gem file. And then that's how Compass knows where things exist, with require in your config RB file. Not the full path to the file, just the name of the Compass extension. So this Compass extension is called style prototype presentation style guide. So in config RB, you would add require style prototype presentation style guide. You do need to install that gem. Good question. Anything else? Yes, no? Cool. Thanks for sticking around. Enjoy DrupalCon.